the 10th chapter of 2 Corinthians, beginning with the 3rd verse. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. In other words, we are engaged in a warfare. If you're a Christian, you are engaged in a warfare. Not a basketball court, not a playground, not a football stadium, but you're engaged in a battlefield. For the weapons of our warfare are not fleshly, they're not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. The Apostle Paul said, I'm going to use some weapons that will be new to you, but they're going to pull down the devil's strongholds. And these are spiritual weapons, the Word of God and prayer and the power of the Holy Spirit. Then he said, we're casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. A person who is living in the Spirit, every thought that he has should be in obedience to the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, thoughts are powerful to harm us and powerful to help us. The Bible says, as a person thinketh, so is he. How do you think? What goes through your mind? What do you think about when you're alone? Someone has said plain living and high thinking are no more. One of the most important things in our lives is who's going to control our minds. Proverbs 16:32 says, he that ruleth his mind is greater than he that taketh a city. Means to rule the thought of your mind. You spend a great deal of time alone, many of you do. So your mind is your only companion. What do you think about? What do you talk to your mind about? That's your only companion, is your mind, for many of you. Isaiah the prophet said, thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. Do you keep your mind on Christ? And if you get your mind off Christ and you get it on some things you shouldn't be thinking about, do you pray, Lord, forgive me and help me to get my mind back on Christ? I do many times. Now, the Bible says, first of all, that the mind, your mind, is at enmity against God. Your mind does not want to do anything about God to start with. In Romans 8:7, it says, the carnal mind or the fleshly mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. The Apostle Paul wrote to the Colossians in the first chapter and said that until they had come to the world, come to Christ, they were alienated and enemies in their mind. Enemies of God, alienated from God, separated from God in your mind. And your mind was a part of that decision. Such a mind will not obey the law of God. It submits to sin. It minds the things of the flesh. The Bible warns against having that kind of carnal, fleshly mind. That mind that is dominated by the devil or by selfishness. And then the mind is not only enmity against God, but it's also a blinded mind. 2 Corinthians 4:3 says, in whom the god of this world, that's the devil, hath blinded the minds of them which believe not. He has power, he has supernatural power to blind your mind. And you let him, you have to let him. And if you let him, he can blind your minds. I cannot account for the apparent veil that hangs over the hearts of some people. Many people very close to the kingdom of God, many people surrounded by a believing family. I know a young man right now surrounded by a believing family, reared in the church, reared for God. He heard the blessing said at the table at every meal, and today he's way out in left field on drugs, sex, all the rest of it. Blinded by the god of this world. They're led captive to the will of Satan. And many people tell me, I don't understand. I've heard this all my life. I've tried to believe, but I cannot. They're blinded. And the only person that can open your eyes to the truth is the Holy Spirit. And you must ask Him to come and open your eyes supernaturally, which He will do tonight before you leave here, if you will allow Him. Yes, your mind is at enmity with God. Your mind is blinded. But then there's the doubtful mind the Bible talks about. In Luke 12, Jesus said, "Neither be ye of doubtful mind." The Bible warns against the double-minded person. James says a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. And this carries with it the idea of a person who wishes to secure both worlds. You want one foot in heaven and one foot in the pleasures of this life. And you cannot. You've got to go one way or the other. So there are many of you that are torn between your sinful pleasures and appetites and your desire for heaven. And you know that you can't have both. And you've got to make a choice. Jesus said there are two roads in life. There's the broad road that leads to destruction. There's the narrow road that leads to eternal life. And there's a narrow gate, and that gate is the cross. Yes, we have minds that are at enmity against God. We have minds that are blinded by the devil. We have doubtful minds, and then there's the defiled mind. Paul wrote to Titus of a certain people who are always liars, whose minds are defiled and unbelieving. We have mind-altering drugs today, and medicines and alcohol and all sorts of things that change our minds. Our minds become defiled. We can live so long with our imaginations and our fantasies that are wrong and against the teachings of Scripture that our minds become defiled. And evil thoughts are the suicide of the soul. Now, you cannot help bad thoughts coming from your mind. I don't want to give you the wrong impression. You cannot help bad thoughts coming from your going into your mind. It's like birds. You can't keep them from flying over, but you don't have to let them nest in your hair. And some of us let evil thoughts nest in our minds. Thoughts of jealousy, thoughts that lead to anger, thoughts that lead to the wrong kind of passions. When Jesus cast the demons out, this man was in his right mind. So we have minds in the Bible that are at enmity with God. They're blinded by the devil. They're doubtful minds and they're defiled minds. But you can also have a renewed mind. The Bible says in Romans 12, 2, "And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind." You can be transformed tonight. You can be changed tonight. You can have all of your sins forgiven tonight because Christ died on the cross and shed His blood for you. And it's wonderful to go home tonight and know that every sin is forgiven. Not only forgiven, but you're justified just as though you'd never sinned. And God raised Him from the dead and He's alive, ready to transform your mind tonight and transform your body and transform everything about you. Your whole lifestyle will have to change, but the Holy Spirit will be there to help you change it. It doesn't mean that you'll never sin again. It means that if you do sin, you'll immediately be convicted by the Holy Spirit and you'll confess your sin and ask God to forgive you, and He will forgive you. Yes, there's the renewed mind. Ephesians 4:23 says, "And be renewed in the spirit of your mind." Have you had your mind renewed and transformed? We are to have the mind of Christ by the transforming and renewing of your mind. You can change your mind and Christ will transform it. That's what repentance really means. The word repentance means change of mind. It means that you're going to change lifestyle, change the direction that you're going. You're going to say to God, "I'm sorry I've sinned. I want to be made a new person." Paul asked the Corinthians, Who hath known the mind of the Lord? And he answered it himself. He said, we have the mind of Christ. When you have the mind of Christ, you have the mind of the Lord. We who know Christ have the mind of Christ. We who have been saved by his grace have the mind of Christ. All of you that have said yes to his call have the mind of Christ. Not a perfect mind, but a mind that's now controlled by Christ rather than by Satan and your own sinful nature. Then the Bible talks about the spiritually minded people in Romans 8:6. To be spiritually minded is life and peace. And 2 Peter 3:1 says, he will stir up your pure mind. Wouldn't you like to have a pure mind? A spiritual mind, a transformed mind. Now when I say mind, that means your whole life. Because your mind, in a sense, controls your life along with your heart. You have a body. Living inside your body is your spirit, your soul. That's the part of you that will live forever. Your body will go to the grave. But you, the real you, is going to live forever. And it's all going to be decided on what you do about Christ. Have you repented of your sins? Are you sure of it? You can do it tonight.